Yeah. Yes. Finally, we are back. Ladies and gentlemen, for the Fringe FM. Coming at you live from the middle of nowhere, the center of everywhere, here once again to give you yet another scrumptious dose of conversational boogie. This is Shift Happens. Slip me some earplugs, Elfman says. What's up, Elfman? Hey, you're the one, you came here. This is your fault now. And, I didn't fully realize how long it's been since we've done a show. The last show we did was May 10th with Kimberly McGeorge. The week after that, guest canceled, and then the next 4 weeks, I was out of town. Did not mean to be gone for that long, but stuff was happening. I had to stay, but we are back, finally. It is June 21st, 2024, which, by the way, is International Ghost Skateboarding Day. That's right, I've been waiting for this show to land on that day. But yeah, my foot's all messed up, but I'm at least going to go putz around on the street before it turns midnight, just so that I've paid my dues, as it were. And the reason why my foot is messed up is from skateboarding, actually. So, proper enough. Now, I believe we're on the Fringe right now. It might not say our show name on there, but it is, if you push play, that's us. We're on there, so. Tell your friends, tell your neighbors, hide your wife, lock your door, whatever that is. Do all those things. Because it's conversational boogie time. And what better way to get into some conversational boogie than with who I've dubbed the all-terrain conversationalist. And that is our guest tonight. Our guest tonight is Jeff. Now, before we bring him in, we do have someone else hanging out with us tonight. You know him pretty well. He's clocked in more hours on here than just about anybody else that's not me. And that's none other than our former co-host, JP. What's happening, JP?
Sorry about that.
Right out the gate. Good.
Wow. Unbelievable. I couldn't unmute it. Okay. Well, I am here. And, yeah. Thanks for having me on, Gigi. You've been killing it lately, and obviously super excited to speak to our homie, Jeff Rennell of eTalk TV. So, how was your vacation, by the way? Did you overall have a productive, fun time?
Very productive, very fun, and a lot of good stuff came out of that. In fact, I'm actually going to have to go back pretty soon, but not for another 3 weeks, though. It'll just be a few days. But other than having to miss this show for about a month, everything's been going great. Had such a great time at Contact in the Desert, and got to MC some cool stuff. Got to bring on Jason Quitt, got to bring on Jason Martell, got to bring on Clyde Lewis. And a couple of others that didn't go as well. I mean, they went fine. It's just, I keep making this analogy. It's like hiring a Black Sabbath to play at a bar mitzvah. It was just sort of the wrong host for the wrong crowd for the other two. But it went fine, you know, and Bassett even kind of joked with me back and forth for a minute. But that worked out because I got to save some of those bits. And spread them out between Clyde and the two Jasons. And those went great, and I had a blast doing it. And then and after that, got some guys from this other, there's another, I forget exactly what it's called. Laura Eisenhower's speaking there next month. Real Disclosure, not to be confused with Disclosure Fest, but something like that. I think it's out in Florida. But anyway, they want me to come MC out there, and I was like, all right, but only if I get to introduce people that I either know or, like, know their stuff. And So I hit up Lore, like, hey, is it cool if I bring you on? And a couple other folks, and they're all down. So I think I'm going to be doing that next month as well. Yeah, I think I found my new, I could do that. I'm down to MC any conference. I'm especially something like Contact in the Desert. That was really cool. Yeah, met a lot of great people and just a fantastic time. Fantastic time.
Awesome. I regret not being able to connect with you. So next time you're in town, we will. Just work and some random stuff came up that I didn't expect, as usual. But hopefully next time we'll be able to get together.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, we might have to. Yeah, we were going to go down to, well, across the border and go have some fun out there. But yeah, we'll definitely have to do that next time. And but yeah,
I ended up doing that, by the way. And but I took my dad, and it was a good. It was for Father's Day, and so. But I ended up going.
Nice, good deal, good deal. Yeah, I've always wanted to go down there. I mean, I've been to like Juarez, but that's like, you know, that almost doesn't count. You know, but anyway, and then also next time you got to come out to Contact as well. Yeah, I had a VIP pass for you and everything that I didn't know I was going to be able to get you.
We were on a phone call, and I got offered a free VIP pass, and I just couldn't pull it off.
Yeah, it's funny. Jamie just so happened to be next to me when you called, or I called you, or whatever. And I was like, yeah, I might be able, like, I don't know if I can get you a pass. And she was like, who is it? I was like, JP. Oh, tell him I got a VIP for him. I was like, oh, sick. But yeah, and then Jeff couldn't make it out also, either, I should say. But yeah, but you know, Jeff's been there. You've been there before, Jeff, and you know what it's like. And see, so you know what you missed.
Oh yeah, unfortunately I do, and yeah, I'm really bummed I had to miss it. But you know, things happen, just like JP's talking about. And I had another expo I had to get ready for the following weekend out in Vegas. So yeah, I just couldn't pull it off this year. Next year though.
Yeah, and at least did we get you that? Did you end up getting that virtual pass that we?
You did. So okay. Thank you so much for that. I really cannot wait to start watching all the different lectures and stuff. I was trying to watch it that weekend, but it was the live feed wasn't going through. I don't know if I was watching it too early and I had to wait till after the speaker was done. Not sure, but I wasn't able to get the live feed first thing on Saturday. And then I've been too busy since then to be able to really check it out. So actually, I'm going to try to at least watch Jason Quitt's lecture tomorrow, because that's the one I was really excited to see. But I know there's quite a few other ones I would like to see as well.
Yeah. And I would definitely recommend doing the Robert Edward Grant was there, and he did a couple of lectures that I really wanted to see, but didn't have time to. But that's the thing for all of you. I know Dragon Rose and Sylvain and Jeff here all had they got the free virtual passes. And for anybody else that, if you got a virtual pass, free or paid for, it doesn't matter. You have a year's worth of access to all of the lectures that were filmed and recorded, because the live stream itself was only from the ballroom, but there's plenty of other rooms where lectures were happening. So none of those are streamed live, but they were all filmed and they're all uploaded to the server. So if any of you guys got the virtual pass, you've got a year's of access worth to that. And speaking of which, there's Sylvain. Hey, what's happening, Sylvain? And even if you didn't get the virtual pass and you still want to see him, I think there's like three or four different packages. They kind of broke it up into categories, you know, like all the Ancient Aliens talks. There's a package for that. All of the, you know, quantum physics stuff, all the AI stuff. There's like four different main packages, and you can pay to have access to those. So, hey,
I have a question for you. It showed workshops on there as well too. Are the workshops part of it as well?
They should be. Yeah, they were filming them, and awesome. they filmed every single thing there. So yeah, those workshops should. I'm pretty sure they're part of them.
It looked like it was part of the package, but I didn't know if that was a special package, like if there's different online packages. I couldn't tell by what I was looking at, but it did mention workshops, and that's why I'm curious, because there were definitely is a couple workshops there I'd like to check out as well.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure how they broke it all up, but yeah, everything is up there. And if you had the virtual pass, then you should have access to all of them. And yeah, one of the categories might actually be workshops. So
I'll let you know tomorrow for sure.
So yeah, there you go. And so after that, I guess it was a week or two after Contact in the Desert, Jeff, you went out, you and Brad Olson went out to give some lectures at another conference out in Vegas, was it?
Yeah, we both spoke at the Integrative Wellness Expo out in Las Vegas. My friend Sheila Z. Sterling, she put it together. This is actually her third year doing it, so next year she'll be doing it again. And so next year it actually will have the wellness part of it, and she's bringing in the extraterrestrial UFO side as well too. That was one of the reasons why Brad came this year, is to speak there and try to get that moving that direction. I didn't speak on aliens or anything like that. I spoke about programs in the subconscious mind. So I fit in with the expo this year. Brad didn't. But yeah, next year it'll be bigger and better, and we'll have an alien version of this. So definitely, you know, people have to come check it out. Sheila puts on a great expo. And also I interviewed Joan of Angels last night, who was part of it as well too. Absolutely amazing. So there was great people there, great kind of, you know, new holistic type of technology there. That's just absolutely amazing. One of the things I was displaying was a thing called Super Patch. If you guys haven't seen these before, man, they are freaking awesome. It's a total drug-free patch. What this guy has figured out is I mean, I should go grab one really quick, but it's just a little patch that's probably an inch by an inch. And this guy created these patterns that are on these patches. And so they're absolutely drug-free. But when you put them on, they will create whatever that pattern creates. And it looks kind of like it would be a thumbprint or something. And so, like, I have them for movement and pain and stuff like that. So Sheila, the one that put the expo on, is the one that introduced me to him. And she had broken her back, and she went to the doctors this last year. She broke her back years ago, but she still has effects from it and everything. So she went to the doctor and had a thermal imaging done to her back. And you could see all the inflammation in there. And her nurse actually was like, here, try one of these patches out. And she put it on. And within 5 minutes, because she had another thermal imaging x-ray done, and you could see 100% how the inflammation had just disappeared and left her body within less than 5 minutes of her putting on this patch. And again, absolutely drug-free. I've been using them. Like, especially when I got back from Vegas, I had to sleep after I got done with the expo. Of course, my family's from Vegas, and so I go to my mom's place and I slept on her fold out couch, which is, you know, it's getting kind of old. So, you know, I'm sure a few of you guys have slept on pull out couches and you know how horrible that is to your back, but I was all knotted up. I threw one of these patches on for movement and stuff, and it's the same one she used for her inflammation. And I'm telling you, man, just within seconds, I mean, all of a sudden I was all knotted up and then I just started feeling loose. I mean, I still had a little bit of aches and pains, but I mean, I thought I was going to go into a back spasm. I was so bad when I got up. And once I put this on, it was just boom, I was moving again, feeling fine. Absolutely amazing stuff. But there was stuff like this that you would find at this wellness expo. You know, just different type of technology that people are creating for a holistic type of wellness. And so just absolutely amazing stuff there.
Right on, right on. And yeah, I would like to try. What's the name of that product specifically? Or where can I
look? It's called Super Patch. And so they actually have, I want to say, 8 to 10 different types of patches. They have one for focus. They have one for REM sleep. And the lady who had the booth next to me, she did ideology. God, when you read the eye, I can't pronounce it right now, but that's what she did. But she said she would use the REM sleep. She asked, was trying to buy some off of me, and I just didn't have none of the REM sleep patches. But she says she uses those all the time, and I've used the focus one. And that'll just kind of make your thoughts a little clearer. It doesn't, none of these patches just like give you a rush of endorphins or anything. It's just a very subtle change. But on every one I've used, I've noticed a difference. Like the focus one, I stay a little bit more focused. The movement one, I definitely have movement. What other ones do I have? I have a joy patch that I bought for the expo, but it didn't come until, of course, after the expo was done. So I haven't tried the joy package yet, but you guys know me. I'm usually pretty full of joy, so I don't know if I need a joy patch. I just figured that would be a good patch to hand out for people to try that day, and see a change, in that day. So,
Did you
so
try
I got a bunch of joy patches to give out. What's that?
the iridology one? I think you're talking about iridology for the eyes, right?
Yeah, no, that was the people in the booth next to me that that's what they did. No, there's not one for the eye on that, though. I wish.
Kind of curious also, the one thing with patches, usually there's one size. Do they is that how they come in? Is it one size or usually they're alterable anyway. You can just kind of cut them and kind of craft them the way you want, but it would be nice to have different sized ones as well.
I threw the focus one on for today. So this is it right here. It's
Oh
that
wow,
big.
it's small.
And so I stick it on the side of my stomach right here, because you truly stick it anywhere. I don't know if you can see can you kind of see that pattern in there?
Oh yeah. Yeah.
You
Oh yeah,
see the
there we go.
pattern?
Yeah.
And so everyone has a different pattern, and that pattern talks to the body and tells the body what to start to produce and what to do. And it's just absolutely amazing. And so you can, a lot of people stick it on their forearm here. I just don't like it being shown, so I'll stick it on the side of my stomach right there under my shirt. That way there's no hair really there to pull it, when I pull it off. So, and the great thing, again, they're drug free and everything. And that's, of course, if you've heard me talk, that's what I'm all about. I don't take pharmaceutical drugs or chemicals. I don't put them in my body, so I stay away from anything like that. So this is something I really am starting to love right now. I mean, the only time I noticed a huge difference is like I said just a minute ago, when I slept in my mom's pullout. I was so knotted up that I felt a huge difference. All the other ones are just a subtle difference. But yeah, really, really cool stuff. And to be drug free, you can't beat it. And they're really not expensive either. It's a good deal. X. What are they? I want to say that the company's LifeWay, but they have the X22 patch that works on the stem cells. Have you guys heard of those?
No.
I've used those before too. I really, really like the X22 LifeWay. But yes, those are absolutely amazing too. They do a lot of different things. It's a different company than what I'm talking about, the Super Patch, but really good product. I mean, there's just so many amazing things coming out in, the holistic world, that is just so amazing. And then again, drug free and just so much easier and healthier for the body. You want something for the body that the body knows how to work with. So the body works properly. That's where like getting nutrition and vitamins and all of that out of your food is so much better for you, because your body actually knows how to, pulled all the vitamins and everything out of there. It's just so much better than trying to take multivitamin, because a multivitamin, of course, is packed with fillers and all this stuff, which is chemicals. And then once that comes into the body's so intelligent, the body's going to encapsulate all of that in fat. So all whatever little bit of nutrition is in a multivitamin, you really won't get anything from it, because the body will identify the filler and already identify it as poison and basically encapsulate it in fat and try to protect you from it. All right.
Nope. Very awesome.
She's having a JP moment. Hey, so I just got to know, JP, did you
Okay.
plan that or what? Because that was absolutely perfect with your mic not working right at the very start, man.
Sometimes it just happens the right way.
Yep.
Yeah, it
And
was like you never left.
yep, just a classic JP glitch on my end there. And but yeah, it's interesting because at Contact there was it wasn't the same company. In fact, I'm not even entirely sure if it worked the exact same way. It was mostly for inflammation, and it was a little patch. It looked like sort of a like on the back it was black, like you would stick it on your refrigerator or something. And he, so my friend Rose that was with me, she's the one I went to Joshua Tree with after. Somehow she had convinced him to just give her one, you know, and he was selling them for like, you know, $125 or something. So she had one, and and I had a perfect thing to try it on, which was, you know, my collarbone is, to this day, it sticks out a little bit from when I broke it skateboarding a while back, and it's fully functional and it's fine, but it does get sore by the end of the day, and but it's nothing too much, but it's just a little annoying. But so she got that one from him, and he gave us this whole, it took him 10 minutes to explain the patent he has on it and how it works, and it made a lot of sense when he was describing it. I'm just too dumb to reiterate what he said. But I will tell you, we went upstairs.
And, guy?
Maybe. I don't. It was one dude.
Older guy?
Yeah, he was a bit older. Yep. And
Earthing. I think that was it.
Because I think the name of his, he called it Earthing. The process of what this thing does, he called it Earthing, if I'm not mistaken.
And you know what? His booth was just down the way from me. And I, when I was walking by or something, and I had overheard it, I thought the guy said that he invented Earthing. And I'm like, he invented Earthing? Who the hell is this guy? How old is he? Because Earthing's been around for freaking ever. And so what it is, though, is he invented a patch.
Right.
That you wear the patch, and it creates the same effects as Earthing does. And they actually have a movie out about this, and so I would say check it out. I noticed it was on Roku for a free movie the other night, but the Earthing movie. Definitely check it out, because Earthing is very, very important for us. It's something that we don't do anymore. We used to just do it naturally before we had shoes and everything. But now that we have shoes and concrete on the floor and everything like that, we're not truly connecting with the earth anymore like we used to. And so it's very important for us to take off our shoes and stroll through the grass or through a sandy beach, whatever it is. But you want to get your feet to reconnect with the earth. Because there's actually, I mean, I don't know how many, but there's a lot of neurons and stuff in the bottom of the feet, receptors to where it's pulling that energy and coming through on the feet and stuff. So it's very, very important. And so, yeah, I had a lady come up into my booth and tell me that she had done those patches. She had something that happened on her foot and she had neuropathy going on. And she did those earthing patches, and she says the neuropathy left, and that's huge. I mean, neuropathy is a horrible thing to deal with.
Yeah, and because we, you know, somehow she got a free patch from him, and at the end of the night, we went upstairs and laid down, and I put it underneath my shirt. It fit perfectly. Not perfectly, but I was able to have my shirt hold it in place on my collarbone situation, and sure enough, like, pretty quickly, like, usually it takes a night's worth of sleep to get my collarbone back to feeling ready to go. And it was within like 20 or 30 minutes. Like, it felt ready to go. And then, of course, we lost that one. And then she went back down there the next day and got him to give her another one. And those things are not cheap.
Sounds like somebody might have had a crush on her, huh?
Yeah, I think a lot of people did. And, yeah, she did a pretty good job of obtaining stuff for free while she was there.
But you know what? People don't realize how important that kind of stuff is reconnecting to Earth. I mean, it's part of what we are. And the more we get into the technology and stuff, the farther we get away from that. And so, I mean, if you're out there and you're having some type of health problems, reconnect that way, man. Put your feet back in the sand, you know, and do it every day. Walk around. You know, and especially now, you know, I know when I first learned about earthing, we always were like, well, I don't think I want to walk around the park with all the dog shit everywhere, you know. But nowadays, everybody picks up all their poop. So, you know, we have less of a chance of stepping in it. But it's so important. So, I mean, if you're going to the doctors and stuff and they don't know what's wrong with you or just can't figure it out, try something like that. You never know what's going to help. And reconnecting to the earth is amazing. And Theta Healing, we're taught so many different ways of going and reconnecting to the earth. So, like, if you're not absorbing minerals, go hang out with the rocks, you know, get some crystals, whatever, go out to the mountains, go hiking, just get into the earth where the sand and the minerals are, and you're going to start to reconnect with earth. And it's going to actually change a lot of the vibration, so it'll allow your body to start to reabsorb certain minerals and stuff. And then the same with like vitamins. If you don't feel like you're getting enough vitamins, then that's when you go connect with the plants, because the plants give us that feeling of vitamins and that feeling of love. And it's just, it's so amazing on how you can just go out and start to connect with nature, and it will change your health. I mean, look at what just going out and getting a little bit of sun and the vitamin D does for you. I mean, I was feeling kind of tired and lethargic before the show. I just went and sat in my balcony and just absorbed some sun, and, you know, I feel great again, you know. And so connecting with nature is very important, especially since we have all this digital stuff around us, which is so bad. Well, can be so bad for us, but it doesn't have to be.
Yeah, and that's, you know, I'm really wondering, because, I mean, we've had things like Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, especially more and more, we're trying to force us to use Bluetooth. I have the last phone that has a headphone jack. As soon as I get another one, I'm going to have to get Bluetooth, which means that's just another thing I have to keep charged all day. And since I always use my earbuds, I'm going to have two pairs, keep them charged all day. And although there is an adapter to where I'll be able to use my regular headphones. But my point is,
yeah,
we either one, don't know, or two, they just haven't told us yet what the effects of being bombarded by Wi-Fi signals and Bluetooth signals, not to mention regular cell phone tower data signals, what that's actually doing on us. And Micah Hanks, actually, when he was on here last, we were talking about, actually, it was a couple of times ago, we're talking about how there's this lady over where, so he's in North Carolina, and there's this lady that lived in his city. I forget exactly what city it is, but she eventually had to move. Now, this was about 15 years ago, but she had to move out towards like the middle of nowhere. She had to get away from the city because she was literally allergic to Wi-Fi. Like, violently allergic to Wi-Fi. They couldn't figure out for a long time what it was. And so now she has to, I mean, she can't go anywhere. You know, she can't go to a city. She can't even go to a Starbucks. She has to stay at her house with no Wi-Fi. And now that's obviously an extreme case, but if somebody can be that allergic to something like Wi-Fi, I can only imagine that being bombarded by Bluetooth and Wi-Fi signals can't be very good for us.
Well, you just got to look at it. I mean, we're energy. And so if we're energy and then you have some type of wave going through that, it interferes with your own energy wave pattern. And so that's where those interference come into play. But as is being energy, depending on how you look at things, I know, you know, there's a lot of things we can do to tap in and to change the energies and effects around this. But I don't want to go there right now. But let's go to, you know, I was just at Space Wolf Research the other about a month ago with Ryan and them. And so I got a new EMF detector, and I was detecting for the radar frequencies and stuff. And it's going crazy in the room that I'm staying. He has this new Conac shed that we make into a house there. And so I'm sleeping in there, and I'm the first one sleeping in there, and I got my EMF thing going up, and it's going crazy, and I couldn't figure out what it is. And so it's like midnight. I'm texting Ryan in his place, so in his trailer and stuff. I'm like, dude, the radar is crazy here. Well, you know what it was? It was my phone, because I had my phone hooked up to the Bluetooth, and I never even thought about it, but it was going crazy in numbers that I was getting off of my microwave. And so, yes, the type of influence that we get from this is absolutely crazy. And so you definitely want to protect yourself. I mean, they have the, you know, those stickers that help with these type of waves and all of that stuff as well, too. You can energetically make yourself impervious to these waves as well, too. So there's things that you can do. But, you know, a lot of it goes down into the belief system.
Yeah. And, well, that's a good part of it, too, is believing in it. Your belief in this has just as much of an effect as any aid. Like, those aids aren't going to have much of an effect if you don't believe that they can.
No. Because, well, and that's the key right there, what you said. If you don't believe that they can, because that's the whole thing. It's the belief. And so you believing in that little sticker on the back of your phone or the crystal or whatever it is helps you believe in it. It's the same as, like, I always talk about this, not that doing the medicine wheel isn't cool and everything like that, but what is it truly doing? It's breaking down your belief system so you believe that it's going to rain or whatever you built the medicine wheel for. All of that stuff, that's all it does, is it helps us believe that. So what if you can believe that on your own without using the sticker, without using your crystal, without using a medicine wheel? That's what I'm all about teaching. It's all within us. It's what we believe. And like you're talking about the lady that Micah Dank was talking about in his hometown. Well, if she's allergic to that, at least this is what I've learned in my practice and stuff, people that are allergic like that are probably people that are very irritated, because all of this goes down into the emotions, because it goes into the programs in the subconscious. And so if you're somebody that's very irritated, you're going to have allergies, because what are allergies? Allergies are irritants. And so the way we hold that this, our energy in the body, it shows up in our physical, and it's so amazing. So I can guarantee you, she has a lot of emotional problems that make her very irritated on life in general. I would put my house, well, I don't have a house right now, but I would bet my kitty on it.
Yeah. And yeah, I think you're right. I might have said Micah Dank. I meant to say Micah Hanks. Micah Hanks was the one that told me about that. But
You know what? You did, and I thought I just misunderstood you. So, you know, because I was just talking with this with Brad Olson. He's doing a parasite cleanse. And so, like, the very first thing I told him, it's like, you know, if you're worried about you having parasites, look in your environment. Look at the people around you. Do you have people that are parasites around you that are sucking you dry, sucking your energy like a energy vampire? You know, it could be your kids always asking for money. But if you have people around you that are parasites, then that means you're probably have an out of balance amount of parasites within you too. Everybody has parasites, but it's whether it goes out of balance or you have the wrong parasites within you. But it's easy to see that because, again, energetically, it shows up in the physical the same ways that shows up inside of us. It's absolutely amazing.
And I think maybe one of the important things is to prevent damage by simple things. Like I know a lot of young people who sleep right next to their cell phones with it on, you know, not bothering to turn it off. But that's something that took me forever to build the habit of disconnecting entirely, turning off my phone. And my sleep has not been this good in so long. And it could be better because there's a lot of other things that I still need to improve on. But yeah, we're even in my community here, I have my house fairly protected. But the minute I go outside, I mean, it's just wires everywhere. Everyone's connected. Everyone's walking around with their head, you know, faces into their phones. And you know, you gotta wonder what are these long term effects? That obviously haven't been enough studies. There hasn't been enough now. By now, there's enough time to at least have studies, but I haven't seen them yet, and I'm sure there are studies out there. I'd like to get my hands on them.
And plus, well, even go ahead.
No, you can go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, even if there are, I'm sure there's studies, but if those studies, if it turns out, this is pretty bad for us, well, too late. We already, our whole world runs off of Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, and what are they going to do? You know, they're not going to, probably just not tell us and just keep, but there are things, like Matt Lamon was just, Matt Lamon's the guy that did that Frankenskies documentary, and he's very vocal about, you know, he goes to all these, you know, local and federal hearings and says his piece. He's very active, but he's also very much about, like, there's a, you know, kind of like what you have on your phone, but you can get this situation for your room where when you go to sleep, it just blocks all the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth stuff out of your room. And I would like to get a setup like that. And at the very least, yeah, not sleep with my phone next to me. I do that a lot because I listen to audiobooks when I go to sleep. But, and then the other problem is, so I live here in my house with my family here, and my sister's over there, and But the routers and all that stuff is in my room because they don't know what the fuck to do with any of that. So anytime something goes wrong, I'm sitting right here. I can fix everything. And plus, that way I can plug in Ethernet directly in for shows like these when you don't want to use Wi-Fi. So, but boy, that's going to be, because I'd like to get my room sort of blocked off like that at night. But if I do, then everybody else in the house is going to be cut off.
Surely I can help you work with stuff like that, because again, through Theta Healing, that's some of the stuff that we learn, how to connect energetically and how to work on the emotions on that. Because again, it's in the belief system. As soon as we think something's negative for us, we've now just separated ourselves from that. And now there is a disconnection. And so when there's a disconnection like that, then it can now become harmful for us. But if we realize, wait a minute, I come from source energy, we're all one, it's just one energy, then there should really be no interference at all, if that makes sense. Or at least for me, that makes sense in my mind. That's where, I mean, I don't believe that there should ever be a thing. I just believe it's one. So I know when I go in and I work on certain things, I'll just watch the energy get to a beautiful flow again, to where it doesn't have any type of interference pattern coming into it from a device like this or anything else. Does that make sense?
Yes. But also I wonder if, you know, humans we're very adaptive. And JP, maybe you remember, somebody put it, I mean, there's a lot of guys that talk about this, but basically every time there's been a new bit of technology introduced, like when microwaves, when radio waves came out, that's, I think, you know, like illnesses all around the world started happening. When microwaves became a thing, all these new illnesses started happening. But then eventually it died down and we adapted to it. And then when 5G came out, well, look what happened after that. And same thing with Wi-Fi. And if you go back to each new sort of, whether it's radio or signals or technological, because I mean, let's face it, humans as a species, like what, just in this, if you ask, what does a bee do from our perspective? Oh, they make honey. That's what they do. That's their thing. What do humans do? We make technology and we make it better. We're always going to do that. All of our economy and our society is based, even if you're just bagging groceries at a store, you're working for a corporation who is investing their money into these tech corporations. As a race, we are making more technology, better technology, faster technology. There's no way that's going to stop. That's the direction we're going. So I would at least like to hope that we'll eventually adapt to these things to where it won't be such a problem to be, just like we've adapted to radio waves. You know, maybe another 10 or 20 years, these Wi-Fi and Bluetooth won't be, you know, will adapt. Maybe. Hopefully. I don't know.
I don't know. Those are good points. I'm worried about one thing, and it's a thought I've mentioned, and it's a thought I can't stop thinking of, and that is that, you know, are we just rehashing technology that we've already had, and maybe the blueprints to all of it had been scrubbed at some point? Because I wonder what, there must be a stopping point. I mean, how much faster? I mean, we're talking about just very, very small incremental growth at this point when it comes down to like speed, cooling, all of the things that help us download and upload data and store data. So I mean, what's next after that? So I don't know. I'm a little bit of not a scaredy cat. I love new technology and learning new tech, but yeah, part of me wonders, just like what Frank Herbert wrote in the old Dune books about the jihad wars, where the outcome was that people in general were not allowed to own personal computers. Only the top leaders were. How did he know to even write this 75 years before personal computers were a thing? I don't know, but it does make me wonder.
Very good point.
I think we have to master ourselves. You know, we have to really be attentive to mastering ourselves before the technology becomes beyond us. Because unfortunately, with us being out of balance, that's going into our technology. It's going into the AIs right now. You know, our out of balance, our competitiveness, our you know, willing to be able to kill the other person for our advantage. You know, that kind of information is going into these AIs as well, too. So, you know, we have to learn to master ourselves a lot to be able to deal with this, the new technology, I think, coming up. I think that's a huge, huge, huge problem.
Yeah. And ironically, in a way, the more this new fancy technology comes out, the easier it is to get distracted from us trying to master ourselves.
Yes, I agree. Right now is a critical time. We really have to focus on what we truly are inside and yeah, get away. I mean, the technology is wonderful and it's an awesome thing if we use it the right way. I mean, it can be a wonderful tool to help us learn more about ourselves and more about our possibilities and what we can truly do as a human soul, you know, I don't want to say as a human being, but once we start really understand what we are as a soul, that's going to change everything. It's going to change everything in our existence. We really won't need the computers, the technologies that we use now, I think, in a lot of ways. So, yeah, I think it's really a scary time. Well, not a scary time. I think we're in a wonderful time, but yes, where it looks like it can go either way here. But I truly think we're going to be fine on the other side, just because of the way I see nature and the way nature works and stuff. I mean, can the human race kill ourselves off? Yeah, but our soul will still continue. I don't know. I'm rambling now. So
yeah, sorry. Well, and in a way, if you think about it, I mean, you know, we consider, you know, like if I had an egg in my hand, that's natural, right? Or if I hold an Xbox controller, that's not very natural, is it? Well, I mean, it was made by us who are natural and came from the earth, and we made it out of stuff that came from the earth. It's all, so in a greater sense, everything is of this earth and is natural. And although my computer might not look very natural, it's made out of natural things, and it's just us having the ability to manipulate our environment and make stuff. So just in the same way that nature, you know, like there's two big oil spills. This might seem like a random analogy, but there is a point to it, I swear. There was the one off the Gulf of, off of Texas in the Gulf of Mexico, where they made, the, you know, find them a bajillion dollars and made them pay for all these chemicals and stuff to try to fix it themselves. While around the same time, there was another one just as gnarly of an oil spill over by Alaska. Now, the only difference is they didn't make anybody try to clean that up. They just left it there. And so ironically, after about, what was it, 8 years or 10 years of them trying to clean up one with human methods compared to the other one that they just let sit there, the one that they didn't touch, that area recovered and got back to normal, like, 1,000% faster than the one where the humans were trying to fix it. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
So
that's the problem. We think we can cure it, and we can't. We're no better. We're nature has it already down packed, man. Our bodies have it down packed. All this the Western medicine bullshit. These pharmaceutical drugs, they're just a copy of an herb. You know, yeah. But yeah, nature is the best. Nature is the best purifier for water. I mean, everything. What's, you know, you're talking about the oil spills, though. You know, another technique I've heard that's really amazing, too, is they put mushroom pods or seeds on top of it, and the mushrooms will grow and suck the oil up into the mushrooms, is what I understood.
Wow, interesting. I didn't know about that.
Yeah. I saw a program on it. I can't say they're using it. I just saw a program, so I was like, oh, that looks really cool. So, but I you know, I wouldn't be surprised at all. I mean, I think there's, just like I was talking about earlier, there's a lot of ways to heal in nature, but I think there's a lot of things in nature that could help reverse a lot of these, you know, environmental issues that we have going on this planet right now. Everybody muted?
Oh, there I am.
Again, really good points. And yeah, like you said, I don't find it a scary time. We're very lucky to be in, I think, awake and alive at this time. We're about to head into some amazing times. I just we kind of want the playbooks opened. I think people are kind of sick of having the most helpful technologies under wraps, and for the few, it should be for everyone. And I think that's what kind of bothers me about the whole electric car movement. I think it's kind of a bust. It's actually hurt, I think, travel in some ways, because the range is so small. And I think back when I first started driving, I can get in my car and I can drive anywhere. I can go across the country. And now it's not as easy. You got to stop every 200 miles or whatever the range is, 150 miles, and sit there a while to charge up your car and carry on to the next leg.
And did you get sucked into buying one of those cars? Is that what you're talking? Are you talking from experience here or what?
You're muted, JP. Oh, okay.
No. I have. I'm still gas okay. powered.
But well, you know, see, that's part of the problem, and especially with these people trying to control the world and stuff. I mean, the technology they're giving us really is an advantage, because electric cars are not at the advantage. Electric, you know, we all know what the batteries do. We know, you know, these cobalt mines and all this stuff, where all these kids and even adults are risking their life every day to get the lithium and all this stuff for these batteries. I mean, it's worse of an environmental mess than it is just getting gas or oil out of the ground and converting it to gas. And then again, you got to use gas for the manufacturing and all of this of the battery. So as we know now, as we're starting to see now, that this is a total bust, just like you said, JP. The windmills are a total bust. They constantly break down. The petroleum and stuff that they use to create these things are just unreal. And, the solar panels, they're killing mass amount of birds. They're catching on fire as they fly over these things. You know, in Vegas, it's a horrible situation. I mean, I could only imagine how many birds we lose every day, and nobody even talks about it, because – you know, if you guys haven't been out past, you know, the actual Vegas Strip, there's mass solar farms out in the Nevada desert. And so, you know, good luck trying to fly across that. If you're a bird, you're not going to make it at all. So, you know, the environmental mess on this shit on the Green Deal, on how they're trying to tell us, oh, this is so much better for us. It's a crock. You know, we all have seen it before, and I forget the Popular Mechanics magazine, but there's another one. But they have hydro cars and stuff, and you know, a hydro car was invented, I believe, the same time the gas car was invented and stuff. But where's the hydro car? We could be using that, really. You know, yeah, I mean, right. But we could be using the free Tesla energy just as easy too, and we all know that exists and that works. You know, or at least the majority of us listening to this show right now probably do. So yes, you're right, JP. We need to be getting that type of technology and not this, you know, this BS stuff that they give us to make us broke and fine us environmental fines and all this stuff. It's, you know, it's just a joke right now.
Yeah, it really is. Part of it. I'm sorry. I just wanted to add another layer to that is people, the cat's out of the bag. We know there's free energy and it can be harvested, and it's been harvested. Why isn't that common knowledge? Why do people still laugh at the idea of harvesting free energy? I don't know, but that's kind of where we're at.
You know, one of the coolest things I ever got to hold in my hand and stuff was I went to a David Sahid event. It was the very, very first UFO event and stuff. That's where I met Brad Olson and Eric Awakening Man and all my whole crew. And so, at the very end of the event, I went to go watch this guy, Larry Hunter. He's an Egyptologist. He's lived there for, I guess, like 25 years here in America, too. But he just got done doing his lecture, and his lecture was so amazing, I had to go up and talk to him. And so I started talking to him. And at that time, I was more into my spiritual stuff than anything. But he asked me what I did. And I'm like, oh, I just inside, I felt like I should just tell him, hey, I'm a Mason guy, because that's, you know, my other trade in life. And so I was like, I'm a Mason guy. He goes, oh, great. And he pulls this mud shaped cone, or a cone shape, but it was like made out of mud. And he hands it to me. He goes, "What is this?" And he points to this black stuff in the center of this cone, you know. And I'm like looking at it, and again, it looked like to me it would reminded me kind of like what a Baghdad battery would look like, but this was like an ice cream cone shape, with a round black thing in the center of it. And that black thing in the center definitely looked like it was poured or made or something. And then, of course, the whole cone thing looked like it was, you know, shaped and made into that. But I'm looking at it and I'm like, I don't know. What is it? And I hand it back to him. I'm like, I'm sure you know what it is. And he goes, and he starts rumbling off a few different minerals and stuff, you know, on what he thought the black was and stuff. And I'm like, well, what is the cone? And he goes, it's a light bulb from Egypt. I'm like, what? He goes, when you're barefooted and you're holding it and you're walking around, it lights up, you know, the Tesla energy. And I'm like, get out of here. He's like, yeah. He goes, Jeff, there's light cans all over the temples there and stuff. They just don't tell you this stuff. But, you know, and, you know, if you have common sense and you study any of this stuff enough, you know, they had to be using something besides torches and stuff there. You can't, there's not enough oxygen to have a flame at the bottom of some of these temples and pyramids. And so, and then the other thing is, why would you put all those amazing hieroglyphs in all these temples and stuff like that? And then if you're going to, you know, light up your hallways with the torchlight and fire, there's going to be soot and sit all over these things. Yeah. And so that's not the case.
Exactly.
And, you know, so obviously they didn't use flame anywhere. So how did they do it? And they, you know, I know I've heard, and I'm sure you guys have heard, oh, well, they put mirrors and use the mirrors to reflect sunlight and get the F out of here. I mean, how stupid do you think we are?
Yeah.
They're going to run mirrors down the hallways. I mean, how big are the mirrors? I mean, now I forgot his last name, but the guy Larry I'm talking about, he was talking about how he believes that they put a reflective stuff on the outside of the Great Pyramid in order for it to reflect the light and create a sun ball above the Great Pyramid, which was really amazing. And he was showing a book from like the 1940s that talked about this as well too. And it was really fascinating. I wish I could remember everything he was talking about, but all in all, what I was getting at is the light bulb cone. I mean, just absolutely amazing. And so to me, I know this technology existed, the free energy existed and stuff, you know, the Egyptians and, well, just this planet in general all around was just absolutely amazing at one time. It had to have been, you know, as a stonemason. I can tell you right now, you cannot carve the stuff that has been carved out of these mountains with just a chisel and hammer. We can't even do it right now. I mean, you go to Pumapunku and you look at those 90-degree inside corners. We can't make those. You know what it takes to make something like that? It has to be made absolutely perfect from the get-go. It's not like you can halfway cut it out and then polish it out. I mean, I remember I was at David Childress's house one weekend, and I was looking through some of his magazines that he publishes, and he had an article on this Caucasus, and he was talking about how they drilled, you know, used another piece of granite to drill holes all the way around in the sarcophagus to make the center part in the sarcophagus, and then I guess he just imagined that they sanded it out, but that ain't happening. I mean, even if you cut your stone totally flat, stone is not the same density all the way through. And if it is, it's a super, super hard stone. And so you're not polishing that by hand or with any type of, modern day tools, period. But I know for a fact by sanding many, many, you know, God, thousands and thousands of feet of stone, the stones get softer and harder in certain places. So you have to have such a light touch so you don't, you know, if you hit a soft spot, then it'll dip in. And so things won't be perfect. And so you have to make these things absolutely perfect before you even start polishing it to get it that way. For those corners to be 90 degrees the way they are, for the lids to fit where you cannot even put a hair in there. I mean, this is absolutely precise work. I can't think of the name of the heads now, the bust of the heads and stuff. They're absolutely symmetrical. There's no way you're doing that by hand. It has to be done by machine, period.
That's what I was going to bring up is now Chris Dunn was on Rogan's podcast finally not too long ago. And that's one of the It took them a while to get to it. I was going to say they should have started right with that. But yeah, when you look at the heads of these statues, which these statues are 20, 30 feet tall, and they're all over the place, all over Egypt. And like you said, symmetrical to the point where you can take, and others have done this, you can take an image, you know, straight on, as long as you're at the right angle, take an image of the face, and then take the right half, go in Photoshop, copy it, then flip it around and lay it over the other side. It's not just close. It's 100% perfectly symmetrical.
Yep.
And they're trying to say some guy with a hammer and dental floss did that by hand. Like, you've got to be fucking kidding me.
I'm going to tell you right now. Because, yeah, you run across a vein in stone. Like, even if I'm cutting a piece of stone on my wet saw, as soon as that stone gets or the vein gets wet, it just like falls apart on you. And it's going to be the same thing. You're trying to chisel something out of the wall and you get this cool story. You know, you've been working on it for several years now. You're almost done with your story. You're at the end of the wall and all of a sudden you hit a vein and half of the wall comes down. It's like, what do? It's like you don't start to, you know, rewrite the story and, you know, the walls are all flat, so it's you can see that no stone has fallen off and they just recontinued right there. You don't rewrite the story. So it's not possible in my mind. I mean, some of it maybe, but the majority of it we're seeing, the obelisk at a solid granite, no way in hell. The sarcophagus, no way. Puma Punku, the H blocks, is definitely not, especially because, you know, talking to Giorgio and David about that. I mean, to this day, they say if you run your finger on the corner edge of some of these, they're still sharp enough to basically cut the skin on your finger. And these things are, I mean, as far as we know, thousands and thousands of years old. They could be 10,000 or more years old. And if they're still sharp enough to cut your finger, are you freaking kidding me? You know how nice that should have been polished up at the original time? I mean, there's just no way. I mean, a stone sitting out in nature like that for that long would have dulled out by now. There's just no way. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, the tools they're working with are way beyond anything we have.
Yeah, and they, you know, because we keep trying to think in terms of the technology that we have and how we evolved technologically. But who's to say they didn't find out some way to manipulate energy first before they ever... Well, it looks like they never discovered silicon-based electronics, which is what we base our stuff off of. They might have found some other thing first, which they obviously did, because our technology just does not apply to what we're seeing here. And guys like, yeah, Chris Dunn and Ben Van Kirkwick is someone I'm very... He's bringing out some of the best stuff, like these diorite vases, which, you know, diorite, that's some of the hardest.
Diorites, yeah.
And I'll send you some stuff about these diorite vases, because, I mean, they're very small bottleneck tops, but from somehow on the inside, they're carved out, like, there's no way we can do that. There's no way we can do that, yet there they are. And I think it really does... I think some of the stuff that Tesla talked about, you know, things like if you want to understand keys to the universe, think in terms of sound and frequency and energy, and then not to mention the 369 thing, and then which is also what the guy that built Coral Castle, Lee Skolden, he claimed that he knew the secrets of how the pyramids were built, and for two, boy, sure looks like it, because that's literally the only modern megalithic structure that exists. He built that in, like, the 1920s or 30s. He was, like, 5'6".
The guy's so skinny.
Frail little man, and he made sure nobody saw him do it, and he did it all by himself, lifting up, you know, tens and hundreds of tons block stone up in the air, perfectly symmetrical, just like we see at these ancient sites. And when you read his little... It's more of a pamphlet rather than a book, but he put out a piece of literature telling what... He didn't explain everything. He left a lot of it secret, but he explained a few things, and he obviously figured out what this other set of technology was that these ancient cultures use, and he applied it and showed that it's still usable. And for some reason, he just wouldn't tell anybody how he did it.
Well, you know, and there's so many signs that we've been on this planet for millions and millions of years. I mean, look at that one, that hammer that was found embedded in the rocks.
Yeah, the Texas hammer.
Had to be there for, what was it, Texas?
Yeah, I think it's like the Dallas hammer or the Texas hammer or something like that, yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to say it was found in Texas, but I wasn't sure when I was thinking about it, so I didn't bring that up. But yeah, but that thing, I believe, if I'm correct, I could be off on my figures here, but I want to say they estimate that that's been in the ground for 450 million years to be where it was at. You know, the handle is the handle was a piece of wood that is now turned into coal. It's been there for so long. I mean, just absolutely amazing. And then, you know, there's another place I heard about in Texas too. Rock Wall, Texas?
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I forget the name, but yeah, there's that wall.
Do you know there is a bunch of caverns and stuff like that under Rock Wall? That's how it got its name, is they found this ancient rock wall there, and the people actually found caverns that went down into the ground and all these tunnels and everything. I saw it on some programs like a month ago. It was just absolutely amazing. Do you know anything about it?
Not as much as I should. I definitely need to look into it more. I know it's, you know, as any discovery like that, mainstream archaeologists and geologists are, oh, no, you know, trying to throw excuses at the wall to see what sticks, but none of them do, because this is clearly something we don't understand using methods that we haven't even thought about yet. But, you know, man, even just Michael Cramo's stuff, not only his original Forbidden Archaeology book, but everything he's pointed out since. I mean, there's this one discovery that's very, well, all of them are pretty crazy, but one that always sticks out to me, which we've had him on this show and he's told the story a couple times. I'm probably going to butch up some of the numbers or whatever, but some paraphrasing. But over in North America, it was either like, I want to say around New Mexico, or maybe I always get somewhere in North America here in the United States territory, underneath a layer of undisturbed rock, meaning this thing was buried under the ground and then rock settled above it around 250,000 years ago. So it's not like somebody today dug through and put it there and covered it up. No. That layer of rock has been undisturbed for 250,000 years. Now, what they found under there is, I forget which India god specifically, but of one of the common gods that you see throughout the Vedas and the Puranas. And as you know, Michael Cramo he's very much inspired by the Vedas. And that's sort of, if he had a religion, that would be it. You know, he's very aligned with those teachings. Now, interestingly, in the Puranas, which is basically like the history section of the Vedas, which for those that don't know, that's like their version of the Bible. That's their ancient religious texts that they've had forever. Within there, and also this is cross-confirmed with the Tibetans. The Tibetans in their own texts talk about the same situation where the Indian civilization, and by Indian I mean India, they once used to be a multi... They were based on multiple continents. They had spots here and there, and they describe this particular region in North America. And according to the Puranas, around 250,000 years ago, in their own words, in the text, around that time, there was a spot right there where this ancient India relic was found buried underneath a layer of undisturbed rock from 250,000 years ago. You know, because according to our history, they've never, you know, nobody has been over here since Columbus, although we now know for sure that there was, you know, Vikings and Celtic people were here a little bit before
Egyptians.
But even then, we're only pushing it back like 1,000 years. But in this case, I mean, to make an analogy, that's like, imagine if we were digging under the pyramids today. And we went down past a 250,000-year-old layer, and we found a Coca-Cola belt buckle in English, like an American Coca-Cola. Well, wait a minute. That's not even possible. Yet, there it is, this ancient India trinket with a very specific god that is clearly from the text, 250,000 years out of place on this side of the world where they supposedly had never been. Although it does say they've been there in their own text, but everybody likes to treat it as mythology. Well,
doesn't the Indian religion go way back farther than anything that, you know, our history says that is on this planet? I mean, absolutely. It goes back way, way back, doesn't it? I
even
mean,
further
me
than
personally,
that.
I mean, I don't study a lot of it, but just what I know, I do believe what was in there, the wars between their gods. I do believe that stuff happened on this planet. I mean, I'm pretty convinced it did. I mean, I could be wrong, but I think it did. I mean, there's signs of their wars in their in the same areas that they talk about on the planet, the glass, you know, the sand turning to glass, so nuclear weapons being used and stuff out there. So I'm pretty sure that a lot of that stuff happened. But at what time? I think it's way back in our past and our history. You know, it definitely wasn't 6,000 years ago. I would say, yeah, it would probably be about 200, 250 years ago. I mean, because if it was only thousands of years ago, I think there would still be a lot of evidence on this planet of that happening. You know, so I think it had to happen a long, long time ago.
And in that case, 250,000 years. So you got the corroboration of the text, the Puranas specifically saying that's where they were back then. And then we have an artifact of theirs dated from 250,000 years ago. Like, come on. Like, obviously, yeah. And I think these ancient texts are really, you know, most people today just sort of treat it like, you know, like mythology, basically. But it's really, I think we should really be looking more in terms of this is their history. And their history goes back even further than that. And
Look at the Sumerian king list.
Yeah, perfect example. So, and it's funny how Western, you know, historians, they just say, oh, yeah, this is all real, except past this point, that's all made up because that doesn't match our proposition for what was there.
Yeah. But, you know, the story of Moses is, you know, in all the Sumerian stuff, you know, way before our Bibles ever came out. But, yeah, it's all BS, everything that they're saying. Yeah.
Yeah, it's amazing that most people don't take these ancient texts more seriously. And then when you start looking into, like, what the Tibetans written down and cross-reference with other cultures, you see all these things that they're talking about the same stuff. Like the flood, for example. Every culture, every region around the world, different languages that never knew about each other are describing the same event.
Yep. Different names, but same event. But let me ask you this, and let me ask you this, JP, too, because you're kind of quiet back there now, and you're looking a little bit too relaxed. But let me ask you this. You're saying that people aren't really paying attention to that. But I agree with you on that. They haven't been, but I think as people are waking up to all of this other BS that we've been fed our whole lives, I think a lot more people are starting to pay attention to these ancient texts and the ancient writings and all of this stuff. I mean, because I definitely can have this conversation with a lot more people today than I ever was able to have this conversation with 10 years ago. 10 years ago, I mean, I remember this was probably way more than 10 years ago, about 15, maybe more than that. But I went deep sea fishing with some of my friends, and I had just discovered Drenbolo's Flower of Life. And it was like, oh, this thing's awesome. And I took it, and I'm like showing it my friends. And, you know, I had one friend that was like, oh, dude, this is cool. All the other ones were like, what the hell is that? You believe in that stuff? You know, I mean, it was just like, you know, I felt like the total outcast. But now everybody that went fishing with us, all except one, because he's deep into religion, is all open to this. And now I can have discussions with everybody now that I went on this trip with, except my one friend, Dennis, which is fine. I mean, he's doing good on his religious thing, but I think people are starting to open up to this. I think people are realizing, wait a minute, we've been fooled and we've been told too many lies about how our existence really is. And, you know, there's way too many signs now that are showing up that says, wait a minute, there's something fishing. There's something more. I mean, again, they couldn't build these temples and ruins. They're everywhere. They're under the sea. I mean, there's supposedly a pyramid, Now I can't think of the name of the lake in Wisconsin. I mean, they're just everywhere. We're hearing about stories of giants everywhere. I mean, it's just like we're starting to realize that our past was much more. We're realizing too that our past, it's been hidden and lied, you know, we've been lied to about our past, especially with the giants and everything, you know, what the, God, I'm forgetting the name of that place too. What's the one place that steals all the giants and hides them away?
I'm not sure.
Museum place.
I'm not sure, but I know I've interviewed a guy, Matt Stone. He lives in Ohio, and he regularly walks in a state park out there and takes pictures of rock formations that are unmistakably huge, giant people, or you know, at least they look like humanoids, and it's just really fascinating. He goes every few months and does another video about it, and that is happening everywhere. And yeah, I just read a meme today that there is a new variant, and it's called Waking Up, and it's spreading around the world. And I think that's very true. I've been talking about these things for quite a while, and now I'm at a different place, and I'm more in a place of practicality and practical use and application, where a lot of people are just kind of opening their eyes to these things. And unfortunately, I think I stopped kind of talking about a lot of the details where the devil exists, because I felt like people need to find it on their own time. And I'm glad people are coming. I mean, there's no avoiding it now. It's all over social networks, and everywhere you turn, there's somebody else kind of popping up with some, you know, pretty cool information. But I think, you know, the bottom line is, I know for myself, speaking just out of my own experience, these are harrowing thoughts that the biggest lies you can imagine are actually true. And I think, you know, I try not to really, you know, go there with a lot of people, because it's dangerous. Some people can get hopelessly depressed over such things. So it's nice to have it kind of unfold and let revelation or whatever this is to kind of unfurl and do the magic for us in a way.
You know, it's funny, I never looked at it that way, JP, but you're right. I mean, everything we were told that were such lies and that was just fake and not real is ending up to be real, and everything we were told is real is now turning around to be fake. You know, what a crazy, crazy. Yeah. I, you know, I just feel so blessed to live in the existence I have, in the time frame, you know, from when I was born to now, to see the difference in reality. Because, I mean, really, I know, I think I'm old, a little bit older than you guys, but just from childhood to now, I mean, the way of thinking, the way life was, the way you looked at life back then compared to now is just, it's unbelievable. I mean, I cannot imagine we're in this place at this time right now, and all of this is going on, and we have a chance to awaken into greatness. I mean, we possibly could live into the golden age of what, you know, Egypt experienced and stuff like that. And then, and to go from the 70s and what we experienced there into possibly being able to, you know, maybe even travel space at one point before I'm done, you know, that's just absolutely amazing. What a great time to live. I mean, it's kind of crazy right now, but that's exciting too, in a lot of ways, you know, because it's exciting watching people wake up. It's exciting watching just the world evolve and start to change in a dynamic that, you know, may look chaotic now, but in my opinion, I think it's opening up into, like I said a second ago, that golden age. I think, you know, another 10 years from now, hopefully we're going to be in such a great place, you know, or at least, you know, that's what I feel. And, you know, I'm really excited.
Yeah, I really think there's never, you know, people ask you, like, if you could go back to any time period and live, where would it be? Like, I think it's right now. I think this is really the best place to be, not just for so many reasons, but also just because, I mean, we can have conversations like this. JP's in California, you're over there in Utah, I'm here in Texas, we're all hanging out, as if we're in the same room, and we have our audience hanging out right here with us, and we can share these. I mean, even just 25, 30 years ago, I mean, you'd have to, like, if you wanted to look something up, like, you had to go to the library and waste your time trying to find a book that may or may not have that information in there. Now we have search engines.
Remember when email came out, man? My friend was telling me about email when we were 18. I'm like, what? I'm like, what is this? Why would anybody use that? Why not just send a letter? It's like, it doesn't even make sense. He's like, there's going to be stores. There's going to be everything in here. In the computer? What are you talking about? Let's just go smoke another joint. This is too much for me right now. Let's go. I mean, it's just like, I mean, as this, it's been such a great, exciting life. And yeah, I mean, I think where we're going is even more exciting, especially because, you know, we are waking up and you guys know, I mean, I dabble with, you know, people call psychic senses or whatever like that. I tap into mine, and I try to teach people to tap into theirs as well. And to do that as well, to me, it's just like mind-boggling that this is where I'm at now in my life. Because I remember as a kid looking at Jesus and just dreaming. I mean, I've always felt and just known inside that we could do what he was doing. And of course, I never wanted to be Jesus, but I've always wanted to tap into those energies. And now it's like, I am, you know, I'm teaching it, and other people are waking up to this. And now science is actually starting to unravel how this is possible with quantum physics and all of this. And it's such an exciting time to live. I think, you know, I mean, we're going through some stuff that's kind of crazy, but I think it's where we have to go. I always talk about, you know, in order to be truly balanced, you have to go from one extreme to the other. And so, you know, if you want to be extreme in happiness, you got to be extremely happy on one end, and then you got to feel extreme depression before you know how to be just balanced in the center, if that makes sense, you know, on anything that we're living. And so right now, that's what is what I'm seeing, is we're living in the extremes right now. I mean, with the LGBT and all of that, I mean, that's definitely to the extreme. I mean, I don't want to offend anybody on anything here, but I mean, just that movement is to the extreme, because that's an out of balance movement. I'm not talking about, you know, loving the same sex and all of that stuff. That's not out of balance per se. There's energies that could be out of balance there, but that whole movement is, because hey, if you want to, you know, have a transgender movement and stuff like that, and you want to support that, which I'm all, you know, hey, I'm all about a person being who they feel they should be. I'm all about it. But the difference that I see here, especially I deal with working on emotional issues and stuff, the thing I see is with this movement is they're pushing the, you know, I'm not going to hold back, the whores. I mean, the movement, the people they're putting the face of this movement are whores, idiotic clowns. I mean, why would you put that the face of the movement if this is a serious issue and somebody truly feels confused in the wrong body? Why are you going to put these people as the face of this movement? Why isn't it Caitlyn Jenner? I mean, he made a transition, and he made his transition into a woman, and now is living life as an actual woman, a businesswoman, and a respectable one. Why isn't he the face of the movement? Right. If he was the face of the movement, it would go a lot smoother. But you're going to put a clown, you're going to put somebody that acts like a whore, walks around. I mean, look at the queer guys that went to the freaking White House the other day. I mean, sorry, I don't mean to. It just, there's emotional imbalance there. You see the one guy, oh, who acts like that? Who really acts like that in normal life? And so you're going to say, okay, because you're gay, you can just, oh, ah. There's emotional imbalance there. I mean, I'm not trying to make fun of anybody at all. But there is a huge emotional thing going, or an imbalance here that they're pushing on all of us. And so, again, my whole point there was that in this existence right now, in this moment in time, we're going through the extremes in a lot of different ways. And that was just one of my examples. And yes, we need to have a serious conversation about this one of these days, you know,
one thing I'd add to that is, you know, I have a younger relative, and she says to me that she's non-binary. or identifies as non-binary. And I mean, I just asked the simple question, how can you be a non-binary if you came, you were created from a binary act? That was it. I left it at that. I think I stumped her. I didn't get an answer and I walked away. And you know what? I don't have a problem with anyone's thing, but
and that's where it's totally wrong too. They're confusing these kids and they're doing it on purpose because, you know, it's hard enough to live our lives and grow up without being confused enough. I know I was really confused as a kid growing up. I'm like, is other people like this? Do other people have these thoughts? You know, so I was really confused in myself. But to have all this other stuff thrown on that they're doing is absolutely BS, because most people have a phase of transgender, and especially as a kid, because as a kid, you're trying to identify yourself. You're trying to understand who you are. And so as a young kid, you have idols in your mom and in your dad. And so whether if you're a boy, you're going to try on the high heels and walk around in your mom's high heels because you're going to try to understand her perspective. Is that me? You know, and then you do stuff like your dad. And, you know, so it's we copy the people that we want to idolize in a lot of ways and stuff. And so as that kid, we're growing up in that way. It doesn't mean these people are going to always be transgender. A lot of these people are regretting their surgeries right now. But my whole point is, you know, if you feel like you're in the wrong body, that's, you know, do what you feel you need to do. But my whole point is this movement, they're taking advantage of people. They're preying on their emotional programs and stuff like that. It's a horrible thing what's going on there. But again, it's where I was going at originally, it's that extreme. And right now I think not everybody, but a lot of people are going from one extreme to the other. And that gives everybody, I mean, if we don't want to choose into it, we at least can see it and we can learn from it by visualizing it and seeing it in our environment, if that makes sense. And so we can learn from it and grow from it as a group. And that's what we need to do, is learn and grow from this as a group. So I hope I didn't offend anybody out there, but
And that's a good point in so many different movements as well that start as organic movements of, hey, like we need to, you know, but then they always get hijacked and they throw somebody,
yes.
You know, like in skateboarding, for example, there, you know, when I first started skateboarding was not cool. We used to get arrested for skateboarding. Like parents frowned upon skateboarding. I mean, they still do to some extent, but we had the best ambassador of all time, Tony Hawk, you know, just cool, down to earth. He didn't, you know, he wasn't a party animal like a lot of us skateboarders. Like, he was a great ambassador for our sport that was growing at the time. He helped build parks all around the country. Like, what a good spokesperson to have. But imagine if we had, you know, like, but in some of these other movements, they're throwing what would otherwise be, you know, a pretty naturally, you know, like you said, some people feel this way and they're trying to figure it out. But then these movements seem to get hijacked and they throw the exact opposite type of people that they would want to lead their movement. And like a lot of the stuff, like I was mentioning before the show, like in LA a couple weeks ago, they were going, you know, these extreme, you know, far end, like going around taking down no U-turn signs because they, you know, they convinced all that it was somehow offensive to them. It's like, first of all, how else do you put on a sign not to U-turn other than draw a U-turn and put a red line through it? Like, I still don't see what's offensive about it. But I can tell you that, you know, I have many friends that are, you know, not just gay, but transitioning. I know a lot of people like that, and they all thought that was just as dumb as I did. Like, those people are not representing them, you know? In fact, it almost seems like they're intentionally being planted to make those movements seem more ridiculous than what they're trying to be. Yeah.
I think so, in a way. And they've implanted these programs into these gullible people that now will create these movements on their own. I mean, it's absolutely ridiculous on where it's going, but, you know, they're giving these people a pass now to be able to create this outlandish stuff like that all the time. You know, I was going to say something else, but I totally forget now.
But yeah, it's just like any good, you know, so many great, you know, progress that is made in various fields, no matter what it is, education or skateboarding, this and that. Well, skateboarding's been left pretty well alone, but there's so many things where whoever they are, you know, big they have to come in and hijack and divert what would otherwise be a naturally progressing movement. It happens in education all the time. It happens with inventions, you know, kind of like we were talking about earlier. I mean, we still need to do the watch party where, you know, there's a couple of good sort of exposés on this that have happened over the last year. One was Stephen Greer's documentary, his last one, which, you know, I take everything he says with a grain of salt, but there's a big section of it, probably about a 30-minute section, where he just goes over, similar to how the Y-Files just did an episode on this, but Greer goes a little deeper into all these different inventions of relatively free energy, clean energy, to where we wouldn't need to be doing all this shit we're doing today. And he points out very clearly how as soon as it's ready to go and it gets patented, approved, and then all of a sudden, you know, on the way to the meeting to get it out there, the guy's found dead in his car. It's
because he went and got that patent, and now they know.
and that's his whole point is if you have, and there's so many examples. There's hundreds of examples. The same technology being invented over and over, whether it's running cars off water, or whether, like, there's this one guy who figured out. A few guys did this, but the most notable one was he had a little box. It took 0.0003 watts to power it, and it output 240,000 something watts, which is, we're told, is impossible. But he had it, but he went and tried to patent it, and he wouldn't tell anybody how it worked and wanted to patent it, and just like all these inventors do. And that's what happens to all of them, and they literally get, or, you know, for YouTube's algorithm's sake, hypothetically, you know, they disappear, and their technology never comes out, which is why one thing I like about the Disclosure Project, like Stephen Greer and Eric Hecker and those guys are all coming together to open source this technology. They've built these labs and facilities all over the place. They're being live streamed 24/7, and they're going to, because they have some of these guys that worked on some of this technology that was seized like that, and they're going to do it live stream 24/7, open source. As soon as they know how to do it, everybody's going to know, because then what can they do? That's where all these inventors messed up, was they tried to keep it a secret, and they wouldn't. And then they tried to, you know, and they tried to patent it themselves. Well, and that's when you get into murky water.
Unfortunately, I'm afraid if they get close, they'll probably just try to shut them down, and so they can't live stream it and stuff. I mean, they'll always find a way, you know, because unfortunately, right now they have the majority of the power. You know, I think if a lot of things change here, you know, I think we're going to need help from other sources. You know, off planet or maybe in planet, something like that. But
that's the idea around, you know, these cameras being on 24/7, anybody can watch. So if they do kick door the place, then it's very obvious what's happening, and they're not going to be able to say, oh, he just accidentally slipped on a banana peel on his way to the meeting. Like, no, we're going to see what actually happened, and that's at least a step in the right direction. You know, just trying to get it open source and get it out to the people so that these people can't, for lack of a better term, kill it before it gets out. It's going to be, as soon as it's out everywhere.
Yeah. You know? But, you know, and it's good in a lot of ways too, because, yeah, you're just saying that we have to be the catalyst. We got to stop playing their game. We got to figure out how to change the rules, how to start playing it, the way we want it to play it, and stop getting away, you know, get away from this deep state stuff. You know,
yeah,
and follow these rules and regulations.
And it's interesting because a lot of these inventions and technologies would really, you know, to bring up Chris Dunn again. So if anybody not familiar, he's the one that wrote the Giza Power Plant book, and he wrote up a follow-up as well. And that's what he talked about on Rogan's show a month or two ago, which is a fantastic conversation. Everybody should watch it. He does talk about the symmetry on the statues like we just did and how impossible that is, but also explains how this thing was very clearly designed to generate, store, and transmit energy. And it's on the perfect location, magnetic ley lines, the aquifer underneath, and he explains it from a very scientific, like, I dare any scientist or anybody that works in those fields to point out anything. I mean, it just makes so much sense. And now you have these, over the last 100 years especially, you have these guys that come out with technology that works very similar to that, and right before it comes out to the public, because they went through the patenting process and all that, bam, knocked off the map. You never hear about it again. And there seems to be there's a couple of things that Big They really don't want you to know. One is, which is, this one's slightly off topic, but one is, what is this place that we call Earth? Where are we? What is this? How does it work? As soon as you start deviating what they want you to think it is, I mean, they'll admit to you 1,000 times over who killed Kennedy before they ever let you know what this place actually is, if they even know. But they probably know more than us. I'm not sure if anybody really knows, but as soon as you get too close to deviating from what they want you to think, they just will never admit it. And the other thing they really don't want us to know, again, they'll tell you a million times over who killed Kennedy and what happened on 9/11. They'll tell you that a million years before they ever tell you what they knew about these ancient cultures and how they were able to do it and the technology that they used to have, and things like Jason's book, Gates of the Anunnaki, and his book from last year, Astral Genesis. You know, one thing you learn in there is that cultures from around the world, whether it was 12,000 years ago, before the Ice Age, after the Ice Age, all the way down up to 500 years ago, Da Vinci was the last known person to use this sort of, for lack of a better term, code, this way to encode information and what the information is. All of a sudden, it just stops. So wait a minute, this survived through an Ice Age. Every culture around the world used it, every megalithic structure. And then all of a sudden, we just forgot? No. It got put underground. And Jason's actually taken a pretty brave step bringing this. He's the first person to bring this to the public and explain this to people. And he is doing it in increments. There's a lot more that has been left out of the books, which he will be getting into in his next couple of books. But he's at least laid the foundation to where people can understand where this is going. But I just think it's really interesting that why do they not want us to know what our previous civilizations were capable of?
And we will know their secrets, and we will know what we truly are. And that's the key thing right there. They don't want us to know what we truly are. When we understand what we truly are as that soul, that changes everything. That changes the whole thing. Once you realize what you are, you are free. You are 100% free of everything because you realize your source energy and you create your whole existence. So when you figure that out, there's nothing, they can't hold you back anymore.
And that's what makes me, exactly that is what makes me think that whoever they are, they must not be, for lack of a better term, human like you and I. Because if it were a bunch of humans like you and I running this, I don't necessarily mean literally, but at least in the way we think, you know, people like us, we would want everybody to be free. Once everybody is aware of who we truly are, then we could talk about progress. Man, who knows what kind of, not just technological, but all sorts of progress we'd make once we all understand who we are and where this is going. So ironically, for those in control that want to have the technology, it's like, well, you're hindering yourself by keeping this from all of us. Once we all understand, then we're really going to make progress. And, you know, one thing, see, I feel like the reason why they know which technologies to suppress is because they already know of that technology. And I think this goes all the way back even further than this, but at the very least, you know, when you follow these trails, a lot of things always go back to the burning of the Library of Alexandria. Like, oh, well, we can't know anymore because it used to be there, but that was burnt down, so we don't know what to think or do. Well, let me put it this way. Let's say today one of our adversaries, I don't know, just for the sake of example, I'm not saying anything, YouTube, chill out, but let's just say China just barged in our country. They just kicked over the country and they're taking over. Now, let's say they find the NSA, you know, the NSA area, like all those, that massive lot of land where every single cell phone conversation, everything you've ever typed in, like all the information.
That's not too far from me.
Right? So where all of the information is stored, everything they know about everybody in the world, all of the research they've done on that information, like that's all there. I mean, that's the jackpot. So now, let's say China kicked doors in. What are they going to do? Are they going to just destroy all of that? No. They're going to take all of that information and use it, because knowledge is power. They're going to use that information to their benefit. And, yeah, maybe they might tell the rest of the world, like, oh, yeah, we burnt it down. Nothing to worry about. But they actually have it. I think pretty much the same thing happened at the burning of the Library of Alexandria. There's not even the dumbest dummy, dumb, would actually burn all that down. It would be much, I think what really happened is they took all the stuff they needed, they told everybody it was burnt down so that nobody would ask questions, and now they have thousands of years of history and knowledge that no one has access to, and nobody's going to even ask them about it because they think it was burnt down. And that information, if I had to guess, I think it's moved around over the last few thousand years, but I wouldn't be surprised if at least a good chunk of it isn't sitting right beneath the Vatican right now.
Probably. And most recently, even more recently, when you look back in the late 1700s that the U.S. Patent Office burned down. And I was listening to an interview with this guy who's a Mason, and he was, builds a lot of yurts. But he was talking about a special cement. So they rebuilt that patent office with this really amazing, highly technological cement. In less than 10 years, the place burned down again. So, talk about just cutting short the knowledge. And probably most of those patents were, able to, come back and be reestablished and everything. But you could be certain that there was probably a lot of technology that didn't make it. And so in a way it was, progress was thwarted once again in a strange way.
Yeah. But, I was thinking about what you just said, Gigi, about them, maybe figuring out and, picking out certain technologies to give us and hiding the other ones away. I mean, think about some of them. If we actually got it, what would that do to our thinking? I mean, look, if they opened up free energy to everybody and all of a sudden we realized that energy is in the air and it's everywhere, it would change our belief system. It would change the way we look at this world. It would change everything about us. So in a lot of ways, yes, they probably have to be very selective on what technology they allow out, because it could expand our minds in ways they've never thought of before, or maybe they have thought, and that's why it's not there. But it can expand our minds in a lot of ways to where we can start to then discover that, wait a minute, this is totally different than what we were told. So, yeah, I think that's probably a big, good thought.
Yeah.
It amazes me, too, at how many, how do people get off on the control of so many people and so many factions of our lives? Who the hell's getting off on this? So
yeah.
I do tend to think maybe this has got to be a different bloodline, a different something.
They're definitely not exactly what you said. Like, I just would never – I would never even want that type of control. All I want is for my friends and family to do whatever it is they want to do. I want everybody to do their own thing. And by doing that, eventually you run into people that are into what you're into. And it all just naturally, who the hell wants to control everything? Who are these people?
I don't know. And who has that kind of time, man? It's hard enough to control myself, let alone everybody else. Yeah. I've never, in my whole life, I've never wanted to control anybody. I've never wanted the power, never wanted to be president, none of that. Screw that, man. I just, let me live my own life. You can live your own life, and we'll meet in the middle, hopefully. So,
yeah. What a, I feel like, first of all, I think this one person being the president system is nonsense enough. But as long as we still have that system, plus it's not like, you know, they have their whole administration. It's not like they're literally doing anything, really. But I think if we are going to have that system, first qualification for being the president should be that you do not want to be the president. That should be rule number one, because anybody that wants to be the president is out of their mind. That's an insane job to want. And and by the time you get to that point, you know, just the way the system works, it's whoever's running, it should really be voted on by the actual us, and that person should not want to do it. That would be, but really, this whole one person represents how many millions of us are in this country? What, like 500 million, 400 million, somewhere around there?
Plus, yes, and plus, it's not an election process. I think it's fairly clear. If it's not, it should be, that this is a selection process that we're in this year. Fair and square. I mean, not fair, but like, it just like it, that's just the end of the story for me. It's people ask me all the time, why don't I vote? I'll tell you why. I don't feel that the votes make any difference at all. I don't think it matters. They're going to put in who they want to put in, whoever fits their narrative at that moment.
Yeah, I think so too. And if we weren't going to have this video taken down on YouTube, that certainly does. That certainly will do it right there. but yeah, me and Casper had an episode taken down once for that. Actually, I think they just put a context thing under. I don't know. We'll see what they do here.
Hopefully.
But even when we do have, you know, first of all, there's only two real options. Second of all, we didn't put either of those two options there. Like they're letting us choose between two things that work for them. We don't really get to, like, even, you know, Kennedy, who's gone independent. Like, all that means is that there's 0% chance he's going to win, no matter what. Yep. That's all that means. If you're not red or blue,
the system has to be changed.
Yeah, the system does need to be changed. And honestly, as hippie as this sounds, this seems so foreign, because we've always grown up in these types of societies, and according to our written history, which is highly debatable, but our known history, we've always had monetary based societies. That's just how it's always been. But does it really have to be that way? Do we need to have a monetary-based society? There's plenty of great works out there. The Celestine Prophecy even gets into it a little bit in the third or fourth book. But there's this one guy, I keep forgetting his name. I hope he's still alive. He was pretty old 10 years ago. Jacques something, or Jake. It was at the end of the second or third Zeitgeist documentary. At the end of it, they had a whole thing about how a society not based on money would work. And I mean, I know this sounds like hippie nonsense talk, but there is a way to not have a whole system that's just all about money. Because I mean, seriously, money ruins everything. It ruins people's, you know, some people literally, I know too many people that just get addicted to making money that they don't even need. They're just taught that that's what they're supposed to do, and they just keep making more money. For what? Do you need a 17th yacht? Are you sure? There's nothing else you want to do? You just want more money? Like, and then people make horrible decisions and F over their friends and family just to make an extra couple thousand bucks, you know? It just, money truly ruins everything. And that's why, you know, not like I'm making much of a difference in the world, but at Contact in the Desert, you know, I was like, you know what? Because we bought a bunch of shirts, Shift Happens shirts, and we were talking about how much to sell them. And, you know, everybody always sells shirts like 25 bucks, 30 bucks. I was like, you know what? I'm actually going to sell these at a loss. How about that? Like, because we paid about $12.50 per shirt altogether. If you break it down, it's about $12.50. I wanted to sell them for $5, but and just literally take a loss on it just to get it out and maybe recoup some of it. We ended up, they talked me into 10, but so we're losing $250 per shirt, and everybody thought I was insane. Like, but it's like, dude, I'm just sick and tired of money dictating everything. I'm tired of people taking advantage of every little situation. Everybody's already paying, you know, a lot of money to be there and to have a room there, and all the dinners are expensive. You know, if there's one thing that I can help not be overly expensive, here you go. I'll take a $250 loss on giving you a shirt. Not to mention how many shirts I threw out on stage.
I would pay one of my friends $250 to wear one of my E-Talk shirts around all the time and stuff. Hey, that's cheap advertisement right there. So you actually did really good on, you know, promotion wise. So, you know, hey.
Yeah. And plus it's like, what are we?
I want to know where you're getting your shirts from. Cause my E-Talk shirts were definitely not no $12.50. I think mine were like $33 a piece, but
yeah, it's a this place Brad knows in out there in San Clemente, and they are the only. We went through so many different shops that refused to print our design on a black shirt due to some technical reason with their machines. They could do it, but they're not willing to risk whatever could happen. This place will do it.
So you had to do white and then the color on top of it or something?
Yeah.
So did they charge you $2?
They just took the risk, and whatever this risk is that the other places wouldn't do it, like they're saying, we'll do it for you. And that's where we got them from last time. We got it from them again, and they did it in such short notice. I actually gave them that dude went so far out of his way to make sure we had our shirts on time. I forget the name of the place. Oh, it's called I want to say it's Create Tricks. Something Create Tricks out in Santa Clemente. I'll give you their information though.
I do that because I know they'll send it to me, because I think mine were just super expensive, because one, I get super nice, I have to have a nice quality t-shirt. I don't like just a regular cheap t-shirt, especially once you wash it and then the sleeves just hike way up on you and stuff. So I always get a nice quality t-shirt, but then I didn't realize it at the time, but the E-Talk logo is like 5 different colors, I think 4 different colors, but because one's black, they had to throw white down first and then throw the black on top of the white, and so they'll charge you for 2 colors for that process and stuff. So yeah, I had a total of 5 colors, and so yeah, they done me pretty good there.
Yeah, because I thought I was wearing it, but yeah, we have like a little gradient sort of effect in the background, but other than that, it's just red and black. But yeah, you know, speaking of which, Dragon Rose just showed up in the chat. Hey, what's up, Dragon Rose? Definitely time for you to get your shirt. So just remind me what size you are, and we'll finally get that shirt to you. We got smalls, mediums, larges, and extra larges. So whichever one of those you want, just message me on Gilded, I guess, if you want, and let me know. Dragon Rose has been waiting at least a year and a half for her shirt. I feel so bad, but yeah, we've got them in. That's the other thing too.
I want one. I'll pay you $10.
Right on. Yeah, I'll probably just send you one. but yeah, it's the same place we got our last batch, like 2 or 3 years ago. And in those ones, they've been washed a million times. Me and Brad and everybody have been wearing them. They look just as clean as these new shirts. You know, like the graphic doesn't fade away. Like it's a solid place. Highly recommended. I wish I knew their name by heart. I would give them a big shout out. But I think it's called Creatrix something in San Clemente.
I need one too. I need a Shift Happen shirt pronto.
Right on. And but yeah, I guess we're coming to a close here. Got to get out here in a few minutes. Real quick, I did have one question I wanted to get in, but actually, let's go ahead and get this in. So I've had a lot of people ask me before and a couple times recently what the difference, I mean, I gave them my little explanation, but from an actual Theta healer, you know, we have friends like John Polk, who does Reiki. What is the difference between Reiki and Theta healing?
There's a lot of difference, a huge difference. And I love Reiki. I'm a Reiki master. I don't use Reiki anymore. And not that Reiki's not bad. Reiki's awesome. Reiki's really beautiful. But Theta Healing, in my opinion, is the most complete modality there is out there. We do energy work as well, just like Reiki. But we also work on the emotional programs in the subconscious. So to me, that's really getting directly to the issue of any illness, any disease, any ailment, period. It is caused by an emotional issue somewhere. So that's the main thing that we work on, is those emotional issues. But by working on those issues and working on the issues that block us and hold us back in life, when we can start to change those and we have the tools to change them and start to create the feelings, because we also do a thing that's called creating feelings and stuff, to where we can teach a person certain feelings so they can start to understand what love is, and different things like that. So there's a lot of different things to Theta Healing. So it's hard for me to explain in like a little elevator pitch. But we use the theta brainwave, and that's where the Theta Healing comes in. So we use the theta brainwave. We connect into the theta brainwave to be able to pull subconscious programs and then also reprogram them, because that's exactly where a person will go to download the subconscious, is in the theta brainwave. So that's why we go there. But in the theta brainwave, you can also achieve a lot of different things. So in the theta brainwave, you can connect with your higher self, source energy, whatever you want to call it. And so if you truly know how to listen into that energy, you basically can get any answer you need in any way. It allows you to tap into all your different psychic senses, and truly you're able to tap in, because again, you're working on the beliefs and the programs within the subconscious. So you're working on things like your resentments, your rejections, your regrets, you know, my insecurities, my judgment. As I start to lose all of that, I start working on those, so I don't judge people the same way I did before. Like, I truly don't judge people at all. There might be a quick judgment, like I see somebody on the street, and so an old thing where it's like, oh, look at that. And then quickly I'm like, what am I doing? And so I really don't have judgment. Like, I don't look at people and go, oh my God, look at how broken these people are. Nothing like that. And the more I lose that type of judgment, the more I notice that it allowed me to look into somebody's body and be able to tap into them and see their emotional issues and stuff. Because when I lose that judgment, then I'm no longer judging them when I'm in there looking at their most personal issues, in a sense. But I'm not reading thoughts, I'm reading emotion. So I can feel the person's emotion and then understand what they're going through. And so by changing, you know, again, your resentments, your rejections, and all of that stuff, you start to, you change everything about yourself. You become a clear connection to source energy. You can, you know, if you choose to, you know, if I'm working with somebody, mainly I'll do a digging session, which is working on the subconscious programs. But if you wanted to come in for a reading, I'll do reading on people. I can do future readings on people. We're taught all these different techniques that we can do. So I can do future readings. I can connect to your loved ones and talk to your loved ones, talk to your ancestors, your higher self. So you're taught how to do all these different things. And so when you're tapping into all these things, it makes it unlimited on the different ways that not only you can heal, but also connect to the different realms, you know, the different dimensions, whatever you want to look at, astral travel, all of that. It allows you to have the ability to do all of these things. And if you're not doing them, you're not, you know, you don't feel like you're able to leave the body and move the conscious and stuff, you work on more programs, and eventually you understand why you're, what's holding you back. And most of the time it's just fear that's holding us back. And so I'm not sure if that totally explains everything for you, because like Reiki, I'm sure you're familiar with Reiki. Reiki, they're just moving energy. With Theta Healing, right, we're going, finding the emotional issue. Because why are you moving the energy on the person? Because the person has an energy block, okay? So they've knotted up. So like Reiki, in a way, is an energy massage, okay? So if you went to the masseuse, it's basically the same thing. What they're going to do is the Reiki practitioner is using the energy, using the symbols to create certain energy to come out of their hands and stuff like that. And what that allows to happen is like when a person goes to the, you know, masseuse or the Reiki practitioner, whatever, they usually are knotted up or something like that. Or that could be an example of why you go. There's a lot of other reasons why you can go. But if you know, say you got a knot in the shoulder, and so you go to your Reiki practitioner to have them work on your shoulder. So they use the energy to move there. If they're really talented, maybe they can feel the emotion that's coming out and bring it up to the client, because that would be a big help to the client. Because what's really happening, the reason you're getting a knot is because the emotional energy is building up. It's not flowing through there anymore because of the tension, the stress. And so that energy from the Reiki can allow that to break up and go away. But once the person goes back and goes back to mundane life and goes and gets in that same scenario, that stress that built that knot originally, when they're back in that stress, whether it's work, home life, whatever, that knot builds back up. So they didn't really get to the core issue, unfortunately. So to me, the way I look at it is theta healing is just where, because we're all evolving. The energy is evolving, everything. It's a more evolved modality that just works in a faster or a deeper way and stuff. So what we'll do instead of, you know, and I could go and I could use energy to move the, you know, to dissolve the knot and everything else. But the best thing to do would be to find the emotional issue that's causing the stress that is allowing that knot to build up. Find that emotional issue, relieve that emotional issue. So then that emotional issue is now gone. You no longer have the stress. And once the stress is gone and the emotional issue is gone, then the knot is gone. And the knot will then be gone. Because again, if you go to a massage therapist, a Reiki master, and again, I'm not trying to take nothing against the Reiki masters. They're absolutely amazing. If you've never done energy work, I definitely would highly suggest it. It's just, you know, like I said a second ago, I think theta healing is just, you know, it's that newer energy. It's more evolved. It's a quicker way of doing a lot of different things. And you're getting to the core issue. And truly, the emotional issues are the core issues. The only thing that truly matters in life is how you feel about life. That's the only real thing there. Everything else is an illusion. It's the only thing that's true is our feelings. The only thing we chase is the endorphins that feed our feelings, that whether we're chasing drugs, whether, you know, we're chasing a band, you know, going out skateboarding, all of that feeds us endorphins. So the only thing real is just our feelings. And so that's what you want to worry about. So you get to the emotional issue, resolve the emotional issue, resolve the stress, boom. But there's a lot more to theta healing, but that's.
That definitely. Oh, we got the echo thing happening again. Okay, I guess we'll. Oh, now it's gone. But yeah, you know, that's one thing I kind of like try to explain to a couple of people that, you know, so it's like with Reiki, it's good for what it is, and it, you know, you can move the energy around it, but that's kind of like putting a Band-Aid on the problem. Whereas theta healing, you can actually really. Get rid of the problem.
Yeah, you're changing your whole existence, your whole life. I mean, it's hard to explain, but yeah, you're changing everything. Once you change the emotional program, the emotions to it, and you change the program and the way the person felt about it, you change every aspect of the person. You're changing the DNA, you're changing their reality, you're changing every aspect of it. And I'm just to say, for me, my life, I was living off programs that were not me, and I was living a horrible life because I was very frustrated, because I'm a happy-go-lucky guy. But unfortunately, in my childhood, I was taught a lot of anger and just being upset and all of this. I had a very frustrating childhood. And so these were my programs. And so with theta healing, I was able to identify the programs that were holding me back, the most prevalent ones. And I worked on them and I started getting happier and happier. And health-wise, it's unbelievable. When I was in my mid-20s, you know, I was doing stone work, and I'm in my mid-20s where I should be in my peak of my physical fitness, but I was in more pain back then than I am now in my 50s. And I work harder today in my physical job than I did back then, and I don't have any aches and pains. You know, I just talked about some at the beginning of the show, but that was more, I think, from what I was sleeping in and stuff like that, because I was on the road for a while. So, but it was more, yeah, I think just where I was sleeping that knotted me up a little bit more, and the tension too, because I guess now that I think about it, I can't lie, I was going through a lot of stress just by speaking at the event, because speaking was one of my biggest fears. But again, with Theta Healing and working on my emotional programs, I actually was able to release my fears. And now, as you guys see, I get up and speak in front of crowds. I have horrible English, but I still don't mind getting up and making a fool out of myself. And I owe it to Theta Healing for it helped me change the programs and change the way I look at life. So there's a lot to it. There's so many different techniques that we learn, how to work with herbs, how to work with the earth, how to work with creation and source energy. And, you know, and that's my biggest thing, is learning how you are connected to source energy. And Theta Healing is going to show you that.
Beautiful. And real quick, Dragon Rose asks, she says, ask Jeff if he has those patches available on his site now.
Yes, check it out, Dragon Rose. If the link isn't working, when you see Super Patch, there should be a link on there, and it should take you right to the website. So, but if you cannot do that, definitely text me, and I will get you the address for that, because, yeah, they are pretty amazing. And I just want to say hi, Dragon Rose. Thanks for listening in. Thanks for listening in, Elfman, and everybody else in the chat.
Right on. And with that, yeah, it's time to wrap this up. So real quick, we'll see. JP, thanks for hanging out with us tonight. And where can everybody catch up with you and follow your stuff and all that good stuff?
All right. So thank you for having me, and good to catch up with Jeff. And you could find me at propertyofmars.com, my website. There's some interesting stuff there. And I'm doing shows on YouTube, hopefully etalk.tv at some point. As soon as I get active, I've crawled out of my slumber. I think I'm ready to go. I'm going to be focusing on practical application. I don't like to use the word truther or truth, but the fact is people have a difficult time these days separating reality from fiction. And this realm that we're in is just filled with fictional dead ends. And so sometimes just pointing out the obvious is the best route. The oldest tricks seem to be the best. And so I'm sticking with that. Trying to avoid getting into too far into the where the devil exists and those nasty details, just meat, and trying to cut off all the fat. So check out my podcasts as they come up, and hopefully Gigi and I will do some more shows together. I'm really enjoying hanging out with you guys.
Yeah, for sure. And then real quick, Jeff, where can everybody keep up with both of your shows and your network and all that good stuff?
Of course, yeah, you can find both of my shows, Consciously Rising and eTalk TV Live, over at eTalk.tv, and everything over there. And then also, I'm back doing my spiritual work and the Theta Healing and stuff. So I got my new website up, so you can check it out at jeffrenell.com. I also have, I'm going to be teaching some Theta Healing classes coming up here soon in another couple months. But I got some other stuff going on. I believe I'm going to do an online meditation where I'm going to try to just do it around the world. And I basically what I'd like to do is just get people together and just come in and just connect to the heart and just get into a place of love. And just push that love out into not only our planet, but out into the galaxy and the universe and existence, and just hold a state of love. Because right now, I think that's one of the things that we really need to do. There's too many people stuck in fear with everything going on in the world right now. So that's one thing I want to do. And also, I'm going to create a healing circle online as well, too, where you can come in, and basically it's going to be like a Theta Healing session. But hopefully, as long as I can get good volunteers that don't mind, we're going to do it on Zoom so you can turn off the camera so you're not even identified. But basically, while I'm working on one person, you know, hopefully I'll have at least 20 or more people in the healing circle. As I work on one person, typically all of us will have some of the same issues. That it might look different, but we basically have the same issues. So basically I want to be able to heal a lot of people by working on one person, because I know when I do a session one-on-one with somebody, when I'm working on them, it always reflects back onto me, the same issue I'm working with them. So I get the healing the same time they're getting healing. And this is what I want to do in a group healing. And so I'm going to do these online as well too. So you'll be able to find more of this information out over at jeffrenell.com. I don't have the group healing stuff up there as far as information goes yet, but I will be getting it out there. But yeah, check me out at jeffrenell.com. Also doing sessions there as well. Where we can do online sessions or one-on-one sessions for Theta Healing. So, yeah, check me out.
Fantastic, fantastic. And for the, you know, like I mentioned earlier, you know, you take a month off of doing the show, and especially for those that don't follow us on Twitter or Instagram, you know, just think about it. They've been checking the website every week. There's been nothing new since last month. So, and if they're not on Twitter or Instagram, I don't know how else to let them know we're back. So unless they, you know, they're subscribed to the Spotify feed or whatever, they'll see it. But my point is, all of you guys that are listening right now, if you know some of those people that don't do social media and that really don't have a way to know that we're back, just spread the word. Let them know we're back. And yeah, we're back in action for the foreseeable future. And but yeah, thanks again, everybody, for tuning in. And again, sorry for such a long absence, but we are back. And with that, let's go ahead and boogie right on out of here. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. The show is hosted and produced by yours truly, Gigi. Follow us on Twitter over at Shift Happens Pod, and all of our social media links, all the accounts are all up there on the homepage of shifthappensradio.com, including the archive of episodes. Associate producer is Brad Harris. Follow him on Twitter at @ADSBradHarris. And wow, what a great time was hanging out with him. And a lot of photos from the event coming from him pretty soon. As always, all blames and faults go to Fran. That's right, hashtag Fran's fault. And with that, have a great rest of your weekend, folks, and we will see you right back here next week. Don't forget to wave bye-bye.